Father Dave. Thanks for listening. Friends, I so deeply appreciate you spending a moment with me as we listen attentively to the Word of God as it will be proclaimed this Sunday, Holy Trinity Sunday, the solemnity of the Most Holy Trinity, a designation of a Sunday each and every year in which we explicitly consider the beauty, goodness, and truth of the one true God who has revealed himself as he exists as three divine persons. Friends, the Trinity is at the heart of the Christian faith, and it's our firm conviction of belief in the one true God who exists as three divine persons. As I reflect on my own life, it's one of the earliest tenets of the faith that was taught to me by my mom and dad and reinforced not only in explanation, but in action. What do I mean by that? Well, the beginning of every single prayer and the beautiful conclusion of every single prayer from the earliest of ages until this present advanced moment of my own journey across the earthly stage. The one true God, three divine persons, the sign of the cross, at the very heart of our faith, our conviction in the one God existing as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, an existence that we don't define, but that God in God's graciousness has chosen for no reason other than love alone to make known to us that the one true God exists as three divine persons, Father, Son, and Spirit. Towards this end, the Catechism of the Catholic Church is particularly helpful, at least to me. In paragraph 234, we read that the mystery of the Most Holy Trinity, right? One God, three persons, is the central mystery of Christian faith and life. Central, that means it's at the heart of it. If we were to begin to describe who is a Christian, I would have, at an earlier age, I certainly would have had a leading response to such a question, who is a Christian, about sin and Jesus' rescuing me from sin, the resurrection of Christ. But actually, the Catechism states very clearly that at the heart of the faith is God choosing to reveal himself to us as he is, Father, Son, and Spirit, one God, three persons, three divine persons. It is the mystery of God in himself, the Catechism puts it. It is therefore, continuing with the Catechism, paragraph 234, the source of all other mysteries of faith, that before we can talk about the Son, we talk about the one true God who reveals himself to us as Father, as Son, as Holy Spirit. Back to the Catechism. It is therefore the source of all the other mysteries of faith, the light that enlightens them, meaning the Trinitarian truth of the one true God. The Catechism continues. It is the most fundamental and essential teaching in the hierarchy of the truths of faith. The whole history of salvation is identical with the history of the way and the means by which the one true God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, reveals himself to men and reconciles and unites himself with himself those who turn away from sin. The Catechism anchors this truth of God himself revealing to us who he is at the very heart of who we are. There is no greater truth than this, and all other truths, as the Catechism explains, are illumined by the light that radiates forth from the very essence of the one true God. The origins of this revelation of who God is they're found most clearly in the gospel accounts of Jesus, although they're anticipated, as all of the Old Testament anticipates Jesus, and Jesus becomes the interpretive key for the entirety of the scriptures, though most clearly found in the gospel accounts. It's there in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John in different ways, through different accounts, that we learn that Jesus is the Son of God, who speaks intimately of his Father, who communicates personally in prayer with his Father. Jesus, the Son, addresses the Father with particular intimacy and tenderness as Abba. It's a most enduring expression that had never before been used to speak of God, spoken so lovingly by the Son of a Father whom he loves beyond all telling. Jesus also tells us about the Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, as we profess in the Creed, who will be with his followers, meaning Jesus' followers, once he, Jesus, returns to the Father, that Jesus promises he will not leave us orphans. He will send unto us the Paraclete, the Advocate, the Helper, the Holy Spirit, the one who is the Lord and the giver of life. The union of love between the Father and the Son is the Spirit. Always one true God, three divine persons. Friends, the one true God is very much alive and active in us as a church. It's the one true God who relentlessly seeks to touch us and to heal us, and to transform every single one of us in the deepest and most profound of ways. Yes, it's utterly unimaginable that the God of the universe is so intimately and personally aware of us and in love with us, has loved us into being. It's the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, the Lord and the giver of life, who makes possible the inexhaustible love of God that is displayed in Jesus. To believe in a God who is Father, Son, and Spirit is to place all of our trust, and it's to place all of our hope on a blessed unity, a blessed oneness, which only love alone can create. Love alone only can perpetuate, and does so without ceasing, and does so perfectly. We don't worship three different gods. And anyone who says that we do is wrong. I remember living abroad, working in the Archdiocese of Cologne, and encountering utterly ridiculous stereotypes of Americans, that some people whom I met who were Germans simply harbored. They were wrong. Stereotypes of culture, stereotypes of Americans, not necessarily negative ones, but terribly misunderstood. And to hold such ideas of who Americans are simply preposterous. We have a responsibility, and indeed we are equipped by grace when we encounter people who mistakenly say that we worship three different gods, to tell them they are utterly and completely wrong. We do so always with charity, but we do so with conviction. It's preposterous. Imagine someone saying something about our families that's just simply incorrect. Trying to insist that we have five brothers and sisters when we have four brothers and sisters. Trying to insist on some other facet that is objectively true, and erroneously holding to that. We have a responsibility to correct them, always with charity. We do not worship three different gods. We believe in a single God that is threefold, yet remains one. It's a mystery, capital M. It's God himself who even permits us to know this. We know that God is triune. How? Principally, most clearly, from the gospel, from Jesus Christ. And the doctrine of the Trinity, it's encapsulated in Matthew 28, verse 19. This is when Jesus is instructing the apostles, and through the apostles, he's instructing us, and says, go therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Friends, as followers of Christ and members of his church, we express our belief in the Trinity every single time we pray, with the sign of the cross that we make at the beginning and the end of the prayer, just reinforcing what I said earlier. It's so natural. It's so reflexive. We don't have to think about it. The one true God who exists is three divine persons. We see this in other areas as well, in terms of evidence throughout the New Testament, as well as reinforced in the writings of the church fathers, the first and earliest Christians to comment upon the scriptures, who understood them in the sense that we do today. How? That the Father, the Son, and the Spirit are three divine persons who are one God, one divine being. Let me get at this yet another way. The doctrine of the Trinity can be explained as a more developed understanding of this foundational truth. God is love. God is love. God reveals himself as who he is, and the revelation is a perfect, inexhaustible love. If God's love, note, not God shares love, not God gives love, but rather God is love. This means that there must be within God this play, if you will, of what? Of a lover, of a beloved, and of love. The lover loving the beloved is the dynamism of love, which never has a moment in which it lessens. So God is not so much the supreme individual as much as God has revealed his essence as it is, as the supreme relationship. And it is a relationship not of utility, not of domination. It's a relationship that is perfect love. With that extended introduction, which I think, well, the Lord places on my heart to have shared, let's look at the readings for this Sunday. The solemnity. Solemnity is a word that we means for the highest ranking feast. The solemnity of the most holy Trinity. We are going to hear from the Old Testament book of Exodus. The psalm response, a little bit different, as it will be taken from the book of the prophet Daniel. Every now and then, a prophetic book will be used in our Sunday Mass as the response to the first reading. The second reading will be taken from the New Testament, second letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians, and the gospel will be from John. Let's listen attentively to our first reading from sacred scripture. This reading is taken from the book of Exodus, chapter 34, beginning with verse 4 and continuing to verse 9. Exodus 34, beginning with verse 4. Early in the morning, Moses went up Mount Sinai as the Lord had commanded him, taking along the two stone tablets. Having come down in a cloud, the Lord stood with Moses there and proclaimed his name, Lord. Thus the Lord passed before him and cried out, the Lord, a merciful and gracious God, slow to anger and rich in kindness and fidelity. Moses at once bowed down to the ground in worship. Then he said, "If I find favor with you, O Lord, do come along in our company. This is indeed a stiff-necked people. Yet pardon our wickedness and sins. Receive us as your own." Friends, it's true, as the first reading shows, that the Old Covenant, the Old Testament, does not yet know of God's profound essence, his inner mystery, right? But what do we hear in this first reading? God, in his word, through Moses, enabling Moses and us by means of his word to have a profound sense, or a deepening sense of his essence. Not perfect clarity of it, but a profound sense of what? God's inner, deep, authentic, genuine freedom, divine mightiness, divine omnipotence, this dynamism that is within Almighty God, expressed in all of the qualities of God that are praised, how? In the passage that we hear proclaimed, the Lord, a merciful and gracious God, slow to anger, rich in kindness and fidelity. My goodness, we want to ask God to be gracious, to accompany us, to be with us this day, as Moses himself humbly and confidently requests. We want to bow down to the ground in worship. I mean, Moses gives to us in this account from Exodus 34 the right response to encountering divinity, which is worship. Worship of the one true God, and begging the God to find favor with us, or to bless us with his favor is a better way of saying that. To bless us with his favor, and to come along in our company, to accompany us, to let my going forth and our going forth be led by God, to really go forth alongside God, acknowledging that we're all stiff-necked people, stubborn, insecure, discouraged, and afraid. And yet, asking forgiveness for these shortcomings, which fuel far too much emphasis upon ourselves, and they threaten to eclipse the mercy and gratuity of God. Receive us, Lord God, as your own. And friends, the corollary to that is because we are God's own. Let's listen attentively to the second reading from Sacred Scripture for this Sunday, the solemnity of the Most Holy Trinity. The second reading is taken from Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, chapter 13, verses 11 to 13, 2 Corinthians, chapter 13, beginning with verse 11. Brothers and sisters, rejoice. Mend your ways. Encourage one another. Agree with one another. Live in peace. And the God of peace and love will be with you. Greet one another with a holy kiss. All the holy ones greet you. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. It's Jesus who announces the inner mystery of God. How so? By distinguishing himself from the Father, and yet at the same time proclaiming himself as having come from God, because he is God. In the same distinguishing of the Holy Spirit from himself and from the Father with utmost clarity, even though the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, is the linking of their mutual love. Lover, beloved, loving. This inner dynamism of God, a vitality that never diminishes. It's independent of the world. It doesn't exist because of the world. It brings the world into existence. This inner vitality, this inexpressible and inexhaustible love, it brings us into existence. It's known in parts. It's shadowy in the Old Testament, as we heard, with mercy and graciousness, defining attributes of the one true God, the Lord God. And here, as in many of the New Testament expressions, praising the threefold life of the one true God, this second reading from Paul's second letter to the Corinthians clearly is able to help us see one that originates, one threefold life of God that originates where? In the grace of Jesus Christ the Lord. God choosing to reveal God's self. The truth, the foundational central truth of the Trinity, it begins with divine grace. It's God doing this. It's God permitting this to be done. It's God permitting us to be drawn into love alone that God is. Let's turn our attention now to the gospel. The gospel from John on this Sunday, Holy Trinity Sunday. John chapter 3, verses 16 to 18. John chapter 3, beginning with verse 16. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him might not perish, but might have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. Whoever believes in him will not be condemned, but whoever does not believe has already been condemned, because he has not believed in the name of the only Son of God. Friends, in the readings that are selected for this Sunday, it is only with the gospel that we gain a glimpse, albeit a faint glimpse, of the extent of love alone, which is divine love. We never could have imagined that the eternal Father, God the Father, who has already poured out all of his love in the Son he has begotten, nonetheless loves those whom he has created in his own divine image so much that he would choose to surrender his much beloved Son, his perfectly beloved Son, into the darkness of sin and of death. Those powers of the opponent that are most fear-provoking, and would surrender his perfectly beloved Son to the cross. A surrender, again, not to miss the point, for us and for our salvation, that the entire action, the entire sanctifying action, is the perfect proclamation of love. We listen attentively to these words from the gospel text. They are words that we all would do well to be able to review, to hear before this Sunday, to permit the Lord to speak them to us. A love that is so perfect from God for us that it's the divine will that we do not perish, but that we have eternal life. That, friends, God has made us. God, who is love, love alone, who made us as immortals walking through time. That's who we are. Or as Pope St. John Paul II frequently expressed, we are incarnate spirits, immortals walking through time. Cling to that truth in the struggles of daily living. That's where purpose and meaning is found, in the encounter, in daily living, in the struggle, when we're stiff-necked, when we are not at our best. We seek to connect with God, to be led through the struggle, the suffering, the adversity by God. God did not send Jesus as the nuclear option. He sends Jesus as the salvific option, the icon of the Father who gives unto us his Spirit so that we might be saved through him, never by our effort, never by our earning, never by our achieving, always our receiving. And of course, Our Lady perfectly expresses to us this truth. Let it be done unto me according to your word. Let's pray. God our Father, who by sending into the world the word of truth and the spirit of sanctification made known to the human race your wondrous mystery, grant us, we pray, that in professing the true faith, we may acknowledge the Trinity of eternal glory and adore your unity, powerful in majesty. And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit come upon you and remain with you now and forever. I hope to see you at Mass.